We have completed one major portion of the syllabus, that is on atmospheric thermodynamics. Okay, and today we shall start a new topic on atmospheric radiation, right? Atmospheric radiation, also very, very important subject. Okay, very important subject and very complex subject as well. Okay, what we shall study in this semester is just a brief introduction about the atmospheric radiation. Am I audible and visible clearly to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Good. So, what we are going to discuss on atmospheric radiation in this subject is only a small fraction of the total subject. Okay. Because this is a vast subject in itself, and there are very good textbooks available on atmospheric radiation. Now, those who specialize on this subject can study this subject for the full semester. One full semester course can go on only this topic, the radiative transfer processes, okay, and atmospheric radiation. There are books available on this by Professor Liu. Conan Liu, on atmospheric radiation, by published by Academic Press, one of the very important publications. But we will not be able to cover the entire thing, but only give you a gist, right, of the atmospheric radiation in this subject. Slowly later on, you will study more. Some more thing you will study later on in your third semester about this. Okay. So, about the atmospheric radiation, I think, or the radiative spectrum or electromagnetic spectrum, I think you might have studied in your BSc physics the laws of radiation, etc. Have you or not? The laws of radiation, have you studied in your BSc physics? Radiation laws. Nobody is speaking, everybody is silent. Have you studied the laws of radiation in your physics? Yeah. What are the laws that you have studied in physics?
Sir, Planck's law.
Yes.
Sir, the Planck's law. And then yes. The Stefan-Boltzmann law. And then right. Kirchhoff's law. The four, yes. There are four four laws. And right. And I, there was another law.
Okay. So, yeah, very good. So, yeah, Wien's displacement law, and there are fundamental laws of radiation. So, I am glad that you have studied those basic things in your BSc. But what others, have others also studied or not?
Deepak? Yes, sir.
Vishal, okay. You have studied.
Sir.
Good.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Krishna, yes. Mobin.
Yes, sir.
Rahul, okay. So, Sri Lakshmi, have you studied the basic laws of radiation in your physics? Sri Lakshmi.
Sir, what you told?
Have you studied the basic laws of radiation in your physics?
Yes, sir.
BSc physics?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Good. So, you have now the basic background already, but we shall be studying those things again here. Okay. As I said, we shall be studying those things again from the point of view of atmosphere, how they are applied or applicable to the atmosphere. We shall review those things once again. Okay. So, either you can go back and study your BSc physics, radiation laws, so that you will be refreshed, or we shall anyway review here also. Okay. So, as I think we had discussed some time back in the very beginning, that the main source of energy for the atmosphere is solar radiation, right? Had there been no sun, probably none of us would have been here living in this planet Earth, right? There is a basic source of energy to all of us, right? And as you know, that the solar radiation reaches the Earth's atmosphere and ground in the form of short wave, right? In the form of short wave radiation, the solar radiation reaches the ground, okay? But when it is passing through the atmosphere, the different layers of the atmosphere, it undergoes many types of transformations or many types of processes, right? For example, even if the sky is clear, right, there can be several layers of the atmosphere, okay, before the radiation can reach the Earth's surface. So even if the sky is clear, clear sky, now there will be some sort of aerosols present, particles present in the atmosphere, gases present in the atmosphere, right? So those aerosols or gases or even clouds, right, they complicate the radiative transfer, okay, and each one of them interact with the solar radiation in their own way, okay. Suppose if there are aerosols present in some layers of the atmosphere, and the aerosols will partly absorb, okay, absorb the radiation and also partly scatter it, okay, partly scatter it. And this scattered radiation again will affect the layers above or below that layer, right? Then the gases which are present in the different layers of the atmosphere, they will also absorb the radiation, right? If the clouds are present, the clouds make it more complicated. And the cloud radiation interaction, cloud radiation feedback, is much more complex, right? Still not very well understood, no, perfectly. Because the way clouds interact with the radiation will depend on the type of the clouds, amount of the clouds, right? And the presence of the cloud hydrometeor contents inside the cloud, right? So the clouds complicate the radiative transfer, okay, in the atmosphere, right? Even the clouds also can reflect part of the radiation, especially the short wave radiation as well as the long wave radiation, okay? Clouds can reflect them back. They can also scatter part of the radiation. They can also absorb, depending on the type of the cloud, clouds will also absorb. Okay. And after absorption, they can re-emit also, right? Like the aerosols can re-emit, they will absorb, scatter, but after absorption, they can re-emit the radiation at its own temperature. And so also the clouds can re-emit the radiation according to its own hydrometeor contents and the temperature, right? So clouds will complicate the radiative transfer process. Okay, but after having passed through all these things now in different layers of the atmosphere, eventually when the solar radiation reaches the ground, suppose this is the ground surface, when it reaches the ground, then the solar radiation, part of the solar radiation gets reflected back again from the surface of the ground. Okay, and that is called the albedo, the amount of radiation which is reflected back from the Earth's surface. Okay, you also call the albedo. And how much amount will be reflected back from the Earth's surface will depend upon the type of the Earth's surface, right? Because the Earth's surface is also different at different locations, isn't it? Somewhere there is water, like ocean, river, lakes. So its albedo will be different. Somewhere there are sandy land, like the deserts of Rajasthan, for example, more sandy, types of soils are different here, right, soil types. So depending upon that, the albedo will be different. Yes.
Sir, Albert is trying to join, sir.
Who?
Amit Krishna, sir.
Okay.
Albert is trying to join, sir.
Okay, Albert. Okay, I admitted him. Yeah. So fine. I hope you have joined it. Okay. Was it Alvin? Alvin, could you join? Alvin?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. So what happened to you? Why you are late?
Sir, I was updating my software, so it was not functioning, but so I had to update it.
Okay. So fine. Still, I see only 10 have joined so far. Still, four are not there. Two are anyway constant absentee. But where are the two others? I don't know. So anyway, try to be on time, okay? We have already started the class late today. All right. Yes, sir. Yeah. So am I audible and visible clearly to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. Yeah. So what I was...
Yes, sir.
Yes, good. So I was saying that the albedo of the Earth's surface will depend upon the type of the Earth's surface, right? And I was discussing that a sandy land like the deserts, whether it is Rajasthan or Saharan deserts of Africa or somewhere, anywhere, no, will have a different albedo than compared to the normal lands, you know, where there are vegetation. If the land is covered by the vegetation, its albedo will be different. If the land is covered by the snow, for example, right, in the higher latitudes, in the polar regions, when the land is covered by the snow, or the, you know, even the ocean, where there is a constant snow, ice floating on the oceans, so there the albedo will be different. And the albedo of the snow surfaces, as you may know, is supposed to be the highest. It will reflect the highest radiation back to the space. Right? So once the radiation is able to penetrate through the different layers of the atmosphere and reach the ground, then after reaching the ground also, part of it will be absorbed by the ground, part of it will be reflected by the ground, depending upon the type of the surface, right? Vegetation cover, snow distribution, water, right, sands, etc., etc. But the one which is absorbed by the ground, again it will be re-emitted back, right? After its absorption by the ground, it will be re-emitted also back, right? And that re-emission also will depend, how much it will be emitted back to the space will depend upon the type of the surface, right? How much is absorbed, right? So this is how the atmospheric radiation, the solar radiation, interacts with the intervening layers of the atmosphere and the ground. Okay. So all that which comes from the sun, okay, are in the form of so-called short wave, right? Short wave radiation. And the rest, which are either reflected by the cloud, emitted by the cloud, or scattered, okay, or re-emitted by the cloud or different layers of the atmosphere or even by the ground, okay, surface, all that is reflected or re-emitted, they're all in the long wave form, right? Long wave form. Okay, so short wave and long wave, you must remember clearly that solar radiation, the incoming solar radiation comes to the Earth's atmosphere in the form of short wave, and all the outgoing radiation, whether it is a reflected radiation, whether it is a re-emitted radiation, scattered, etc., they're all in the long wave form. Okay. Now, what is the definition of the long wave, or what is the definition of the short wave? Where do we say it is long wave, and when do we say it is a short wave according to the wavelength, right? When we say short wave or long wave, it must be according to the wavelength, right? So, well, we shall discuss about that. So, in this lecture, in the atmospheric radiation that we shall study in the next few classes, okay, we shall talk about the fundamental laws of radiation, now part of which you have already studied in your BSc, okay? Then simple radiative transfer processes that we shall discuss. We shall discuss about the complex radiative transfer processes. Okay, we shall talk about the cloud radiation interaction and the radiation budgets of the atmosphere. Okay, so these are the topics which we shall discuss in the next coming classes. But although I said that, you know, these are just this brief introduction. Okay, and we will not be able to cover the details of each because that is a full semester course. If somebody wants to study now the complete atmospheric radiation, then that is a full semester course, and he has to study whole textbook on atmospheric radiation. Okay. So now let's see. Let's talk about the fundamental laws of radiation. Okay. Now this is an electromagnetic spectrum. This diagram illustrates the electromagnetic spectrum, right? Electromagnetic spectrum that you already know. Depending upon the wavelength, right? The electromagnetic spectrum can span from long waves, television and radio waves, radio and television waves, to microwaves of radar, right? To infrared, to visible, right? To ultraviolet, to X-ray, to gamma ray, to cosmic rays, right? So this is the entire spectrum of the electromagnetic radiation, right? That you must have studied in your BSc, isn't it? And the long wave, like radio and television waves, their wavelength can be very large, 10 power 9, 10 power 12, okay, meter. This is one, okay? In the scale of wavelength, starting from one, now if you go left hand side for the long wave, they've got 10 power 3, 10 power 6, 10 power 9, 10 power 12, and on the short wave side, they've got minus 3, minus 6, and so on, right? Nanometer scale, where 1 nanometer is 10 power minus 9, right? Meters. So, as I said, that the solar incoming solar radiation is always in the form of short wave. And the short wave radiation are those whose wavelength is less than 4 micron. Okay. Short wave radiation are those whose wavelength is less than 4 micron. Whereas the long wave radiation is that whose wavelength is more than or greater than 4 micron. So the long wave radiation is also called the terrestrial radiation. Terrestrial radiation, okay. Because Earth's surface, all the planet, whether it is Earth or any other planet, the radiation which is reflected back from there is called the terrestrial radiation, right? So terrestrial radiations are in the form of long wave, which is having wavelength greater than 4 micron, okay. Whereas the visible, the most important part of the solar radiation, the one which is visible, that has the wavelength, as you must be knowing that, now from 0.38 to 0.74 micron, okay, the wavelength of the visible radiation is in this range, 0.38 to 0.74 micron, okay. By the way, you must be knowing what is the speed of the light, right? Isn't it? You must have studied that in your basic textbook of school. Speed of the light is given by this one, 2.998 times 10 power 8 meters per second. Right? This is the speed of the light. Okay. So, as I said, the visible radiation is in the wavelength range from 0.38 to 0.74 micron. Okay, this part of the spectrum is visible. Okay. Now, interestingly, depending upon the wavelength, okay, depending upon the wavelength, sometimes the solar radiation is transparent to the atmosphere. Depending upon the wavelength of radiation, the atmosphere is transparent or opaque to that wavelength band, right? It's very important to learn that what are those wavelength bands which are transparent to the atmospheric radiation. The radiation in those wavelength band can escape easily to the space, right? The radiation in those wavelength band can escape to the space. So they are also called the atmospheric window. Atmospheric window, right? Because the radiation can escape to the space through that window, atmospheric window, right? Have you heard about this term called atmospheric window? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, very good. Right. So the radiation can escape to the space because the different substances, for example, the gaseous substances, or gases which are present in the atmosphere, some of them absorb some part of the radiation very strongly, while some of them are opaque or transparent to a particular band of radiation. So in the remote sensing, when the remote sensing we do, using satellites, right, we develop the sensors exploiting these features or characters of the electromagnetic radiation band, right? Because you see, nowadays we say that we can measure many atmospheric parameters using the satellites, right? Based upon the satellites, we can use many atmospheric properties, characteristics. For instance, besides the normal things that you may be knowing, like normally we can derive the temperature profiles of the atmosphere, we can derive the water vapor content of the atmosphere, right? From the satellite, as you may be knowing, that we can measure how much water vapor is present in the atmosphere, right? What is the wind? How much is the wind speed and the direction also? But that is slightly different, right? But satellites can measure the temperature profiles of the atmosphere. Satellites can measure the water vapor or humidity, specific humidity, mixing ratios, all, right, of the atmosphere. And also it can measure the types of gases, which gas is present, how much in quantity. Those things also we can measure through satellites, right? Depending upon the type of the satellite and depending upon the type of the sensor that is fitted to the satellite. I mean, depends on the purpose of the satellite, because satellites are launched for different purposes, right? And you must be knowing that there are so many satellites nowadays circling the Earth, right? The planet Earth. There are so many types of satellites, probably hundreds of satellites are now circling the Earth. And each of them have their own purpose. There are some satellites which are dedicated only for the meteorological purpose, right? Meteorological, they call the meteorological satellites. So we fit the sensors in those satellites specifically for atmospheric measurement, right? Like how much is the water vapor, for instance, right? What is the temperature? Etc., etc. So they are the meteorological satellites. And also, it has got different sensors for the visible or infrared band, right? So you must have seen the satellite picture. Have you seen the satellite images more, deeply, carefully? Have you seen the IMD's website? Oops. India Met Department website. Have you seen that? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So if you have seen the IMD website, have you seen the satellite images in the website? Yes or no?
Yes, sir. On the right top.
Yeah, imd.gov.in. I just type in. Okay, I hope my internet is faster. Okay, now you can see that. See, satellite, right? If you see the satellite, you can see, is this screen visible to all of you?
Yes, sir.
You can see from this screen, this is the satellite image from InSat 3D, right? InSat, oops. I'm not able to use the pointer here. Okay. So I just moved the cursor. So this is from the InShot 3D image. Okay. And this image is for the, let us see, this is for the, this is for the infrared one, IR1. Okay. This is the IR1's image. And this is the current image, right? The current image of the atmosphere over India, right? 7th of January and Indian time 12:30 to 12:57, almost current, now is 1:30, right? So this is the current image of the, from the satellite of the Earth's atmosphere. You can see that this entire northwestern part of India is having fog. See light, are you able to see the light shadings here? Light shadings, this is visible to you, light shadings. Yes or no?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Light shadings. So generally they are the fog, okay? And these bright patches, these bright patches that you see over the Arabian Sea and also over the Bay of Bengal, they are actually the convective clouds of the same image. What you are seeing right now is the IR band, okay, infrared band, okay, 10.8 micron band is what is written here. Infrared image in the 10.8 micron band, okay. Now the same image, if you watch on the visible, how will it look like? Now, this is the visible image. See the difference. Could you notice the difference between visible and the infrared image? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So now the visible image is different. This is from the visible band, 0.65 micron, okay? 0.565 micron band. This is the visible band of the radiation, right? Now, the thing is, the visible band will be visible only where there is a day. Only where there is a sunlight, this part will be visible. So as you can see that the eastern part, right now it is already 1:30, so now sun is almost on our head, it's on the zenith, right? Central part of India is illuminated. That's why central part of India is illuminated. But if we go more and more west or more and more east, that they are not so bright. See, this part is not so bright. Although things are there, but not so bright. Similarly, things are there, but not so bright, as much bright as here, right? This is called, it's a visible image, right? And visible image will depend upon the time of the day at that location, right? Here we have in India right now about 1:30, but if you go more and more west, it will be early in the day, right? If you go to London, London will be about how much now? About 8:30 or 9 o'clock, okay? Or maybe 8 o'clock, even less than 8, 7:30 in the morning, because 5.5 hour difference between London and New Delhi time is 5.5 hour difference. So now it's 1:30. So it's about 8 o'clock in the morning, right? At London, it is 8 o'clock in the morning. It is not visible in this map. It's, you can see only here, up to, I think, this is Iran, part of the Iran, right? This is Saudi Arabia, Riyadh, right? So Kabul, this is Kabul, okay, Yemen. So still, I mean, you can see only the, up to this part of the globe, because this is a geostationary satellite, right? You can't see the whole globe. In order to see the London right now, the satellite image of London, you have to see the Meteosat, right? Meteosat, which is launched by the European Satellite Agency. This is from our satellite, Indian satellite. This image is from the Indian satellite, and because this is a geostationary image, so this can't see the whole globe. This can see only this part of the Earth. Of course, this is projected now. This is not the hemisphere, entire hemisphere. But so to see the London image at London right now, you have to see the Meteosat. Or to see the image in USA right now, you have to look at the image of GOES, right? That is the NOAA satellite. So, so many satellites. Yeah.
So is, that global could be, I think we can use that global.
Yeah, but that will be only hemispheric. There is a, yeah, you can see the global, but that will be hemispheric, not the whole globe on this one. But up to whatever extent the the INSAT can cover. Globally is there below, like here. So if you see visible, it's not global actually, it will be only hemispheric. See, it will be only hemispheric, right? So hemispheric because the INSAT is placed approximately at 74 degrees east. The geostationary satellite have a fixed location, right? So the INSAT generally is about between 74 to 80, or this is 80 degree longitude. This is 70 degree longitude. So INSAT is somewhere in between, right? So it can see the Indian region, now the best view it can get for the Indian region, and that's the purpose for Indian satellite, to see the Indian region, to get the best view of the Indian region, right? But if you go more and more west or more and more east, the visual will not be so clear. If you want to see more, better, because this is Europe. This part is Europe, okay? This is Africa, this is Saudi Arabia. Europe is somewhere here. You can't see Europe properly here, right? Similarly, you can see part of the Japanese island, but not properly. These are Korean islands, not properly, not fully. This is Taiwan, okay? This is Taiwan. So Japan is further east. So for them, they have their own satellites, GMS. The geostationary meteorological satellite, that is a Japanese satellite. So they have launched in such a way that they are focusing on the Japanese region. Similarly, you can't see any part of the USA here, right? You can't see any part of the USA because there is just on the other side of the Earth. And to see the US, you have to see the GOJ satellite image. GOJ, that is the satellite of NOAA. Right, launched by NOAA. You have heard of NOAA, right? You know about the NOAA? Yes or no? NOAA? Have you heard about this? Yes or no? Everybody is silent. Have you heard about the NASA?
Yes, sir.
Okay, everybody has heard about the NASA, but since nobody has heard about the NOAA, right? Now, they are sisters. NASA and NOAA are sisters, okay? NASA is more for the development of the rockets, the hardwares, the satellites, etc., etc. But this is more dedicated for atmospheric science purpose, meteorological purpose, NOAA. Right, meteorological or atmospheric, right? Okay, whereas NASA is for the basically launching the satellites, right? Sending the man to the moon or to the space station, etc., etc. More on the ISRO does both the things for us, right? But in USA, they are done separately. Now, you know the full form of NASA, right? NASA, National Aeronautics
Space
Administration, not agency, it is administration, right? National Aeronautics and Space Administration. Okay, whereas NOAA is National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. Okay. So in our India, this NOAA is equivalent to our Ministry of Earth Sciences, Have you heard of the Ministry of Earth Sciences? MOES.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I mean, all these weather-related things, weather and ocean-related things are dealt by the Ministry of Earth Sciences. And under this comes all this IMD, NCMRWF, okay, and so many, what, 10, 12, NIOT, have you heard of NIOT? NIOT, National Institute of OSM Technology, this is in Chennai, NIOT, NCMRWF is National Center for Medium Rain Weather Forecasting, is in Delhi, Noida, IMD, you know, India Department, right? And then many others, INQAS, I was discussing yesterday, telling you in the orientation class, COIS, INQAS, this is in Hyderabad, Indian National Center for Ocean Information Center Services, right? So this is INQAS, this is under MOES at Hyderabad. There is also ENQAR, N-C-A-O-R, this is at Goa, National Center for Antarctic Ocean Research. Antarctic Ocean Research, this is at Goa. And many more there are. This is also recently ANSES, C-E-S. This is at Trivandrum, National Center for Earth System Studies, Trivandrum. I think there are maybe about 10, 12 are there. Under this MOES, there are 10, 12, IITM also. IITM. Indian Institute of Tropical Meteorology, right? These are Pune, and many more. Okay, so they are all under MOES. So this is equivalent to the NOAA here, right? Like NOAA is the main organization which is under which the National Weather Service of USA, NWS, National Weather Service of USA, okay, NSEP, you have heard about the NSEP, National Center for Environmental Prediction, just like our NCMRWF, they have got NSEP. And there are many labs, just like we have got so many labs, they have got also many labs, NSEP, they have NSSL, National Severe Storm Laboratory, NSSL, National Severe Storm Laboratory, right? They have got NHC, National Hurricane Center, NHC, National Hurricane Center, right? All that which is related to their hurricane, cyclone, etc., that is all done here. All that related to severe storms, that is done here, right? The day-to-day weather forecasting up to medium rain is done here, NSEP, under the NWS, right? And so many things, right? Now, equivalent to NASA for us is ISRO, that you know, right, ISRO? Yes or no? ISRO?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, ISRO.
Yes, sir.
And just like ISRO has got so many branches, right, all over India, right? Among them, for example, now, of course, BSSC is a most important one, Vikram Sarabhai Space Center in Trivandrum, right? Inside the Vikram Sarabhai Space Center, there are so many, you know, divisions or laboratories like, you know, SPL, the Space Physics Laboratory, right? Which works related to our field, atmospheric science, Space Physics Laboratory, and so on. They've got a Space Application Center, SAC. But this is at Ahmedabad, a Space Application Center, right? They've got IIRS, Indian Institute of Remote Sensing, that is in Dehradun, right? They've got NRSA, National Remote Sensing Agency, that is at Hyderabad, right? And so many things. They've got Radar Development Cell, that is at Bangalore. And Bangalore, they have got many more labs also. Just like at Trivandrum, they have got so many labs. Also at Bangalore, they have so many. They have got an institute especially under them, IIST, Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology. Just like we have got the IITM, Indian Institute of Tropical Meteorology. Similarly, IIST, Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology. That is under the ISRO. Okay. So, ISRO is equivalent to NASA. And similarly, NASA also has got many labs. No, so many labs. Like, there, our, you know, of course, SAR is there, of course, SAR, Sri Harikota range, from where now the India launches all its satellites, SAR. You have heard of the SAR, right? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah,
yes, SAR. Sir.
All the Indian satellites are launched from here. But for USA, there were two, three places. We have got only one place now to launch the satellite, but there were two, three places. Like, they have got Johnson Space Center. Johnson Space Center is Florida, and many more. There are so many of them. I mean, California also, they have got launching site. They have got Jet Propulsion Laboratory, JPL. They have got Goddard Space Flight Center, GSFC. Goddard Space Flight Center. Have you heard of this GSFC? Goddard Space Flight Center. Yes or no?
No, sir. No, sir.
These are Maryland. Yeah, these are Maryland. Actually, I worked at this place for 2 years, ESFC at Maryland. So at Goddard Space Flight Center, they have laboratories for atmosphere. Laboratory for atmosphere. Atmospheric science, LAS. And they also have laboratory for development of sensors. Just like the SAC we have in Ahmedabad. Similarly, they have got the labs for central. I mean, inside the GSFC itself, inside the GSFC, this is the Goddard Space Flight Center. Okay, this is part of the NASA at Maryland. Now, inside this Goddard Space Flight Center, they've got so many branches, offices. Some of them work on atmosphere, some of them work on modeling. Okay. Modeling of their processes, clouds, okay, climate, and so on, right? Also, I mean, about the sensors, development of sensors. Okay. So, you know, the Goddard, this is the name of a scientist. Interestingly, not interestingly, it is actually named after the scientist whose name was Goddard. Have you heard of that Goddard scientist? Yes or no?
No, sir.
Yeah, actually, he's the one who, developed the first rocket for NASA. Just like for India, it was the Vikram Sarabhai, right? For India, ISRO. Have you heard of this name? Vikram
Sarabhai. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yeah. For yes, India, sir.
Yeah. For India, it is Vikram Sarabhai. Now, on whose name they have got the BSSC. The main, the father of the ISRO, you can say, Vikram Sarabhai. Similarly, for NASA, it is the Goddard, who developed the first rocket for NASA, right? So I actually was there for 2 years. This lab. So, and there are many labs, just like ISRO has got so many labs. All these labs are belonging to ISRO. Similarly, NASA also have got so many labs. Right? So anyway, all these things, you know, are out of the subject, but just for your information, because we're talking about the atmospheric radiation, how we try to utilize, how we try to utilize the characteristics of different substances, no, in absorbing the atmospheric radiation, like water vapor absorbs radiation in certain band, certain electromagnetic band, right? Similarly, the carbon dioxide, for example, will absorb maximum radiation in some other band, right? And so on, other so many gases, great variety of gases, they will absorb the atmospheric radiation in different bands, right? And so we call channels. This satellite has that many channels. Those channels are nothing but the bands, electromagnetic bands, devoted or dedicated for measuring a particular substance in the atmosphere. Dust particles, how we measure the dust particles in the atmosphere? How do we measure? Depends on, again, the channel, the atmospheric radiation band. Okay. I think part of it you might study in the satellite meteorology. You have got a course on satellite meteorology. Yes, I think next semester maybe. Okay. I'm just talking about the fundamental things only, basics. For details, you will study in the satellite meteorology course. Okay. So this is about the electromagnetic radiation. Okay. Electromagnetic radiation, which span from very long wave, radio and television wave, to very short waves, okay, X-ray, gamma ray, cosmic rays, etc. Okay. And this color is depicting that which band is affected by which type. Like this greenish thing, this greenish band is the atmospheric window. This is the atmospheric window, greenish band. This color is depicting the emitted radiation from the sun. That is, they're all in the short wave form. All in the short wave form. This color is on the short wave form. Okay. And this is emitted by the Earth. This color is the one which is emitted by the Earth, that is in the long wave form. Okay. So this is about the electromagnetic spectrum. Okay. I think today we have to stop. It's already 1:50 now. So we stop here for today. All right. And we shall continue the class tomorrow. Okay. Any question for now?
No, sir.
So I stop sharing the screen. All right. And there we go. Okay. So anybody left for the attendance? I see only 10 people.
Sir, me, sir.
I joined.
Small and Alvin. Okay, fine. So
fine. Sir,
your, me. Okay, so you will be all recorded in the log. Your name will be recorded in the log. Okay, then see you tomorrow, right?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Bye.